funny, y'all. Facebook, I don't own the copyrights to the music. Let me turn this down a little bit. Good morning, y'all. I'm a little early, but I just had a few announcements to make this morning. First of all, at 1:30 p.m. sharp, I will be going live with attorney Tanya Sweat. We will be streaming live from YouTube, Facebook, as well as TikTok at 1:30 p.m. Okay, we're going to be talking about the Jim Crow law that they just put in effect in Mississippi. Okay, we're going to give you the facts, okay? And there's several facts that you need to know about this law, right? And we're going to have to talk about it, okay? It's very important that we talk about this situation. They're putting different laws into effect all over the place, y'all, all over the place. So we're going to have to really understand what's going on and how things have changed with the law, what things will change with the law, okay? Because I understand that a lot of people is really not taking this situation serious as they should. And you should be taking it serious, you guys, for real. If they can pass a law like that in Mississippi, just imagine what they will be able to do in your state, your city. Okay, I don't think a lot of you all are really taking that serious. So we're going to talk about that, and we're going to explain the facts on that law that they just unanimously voted for. Okay, because they did. All right, and what you need to know is that it is. It's horrifying in a sense, and we have people that are really, really running scared behind this situation. A lot of people are running scared, okay, because one thing, they're really not understanding the true facts when it comes to this law that they're putting into place. God damn it. They're not understanding the law that they have put into place. They're not understanding it. I'm seeing a lot of TikTok videos, and you know, people are putting up posts. People are kind of running scared on the facts, right, of what's really going on. And I'm telling you all, it's a lot, you know, that you have to really worry about when it comes to this law that they're trying to pass in Mississippi, that they have passed in Mississippi, and how it could affect the rest of the country, because we can have that law as well. We will be affected. We could be affected as well, okay, because it's all about our senators, right? Y'all pay too much attention to the presidential candidacy, y'all. I'm telling y'all, it's bigger than that. It really is. It is really bigger than that, right? And so y'all have to start paying attention to what's out there. Take it serious, okay? Because, like I said, just because they have passed that law in Mississippi, it does not mean, good morning, cousin. It does not mean that it can't happen in our part of the, you know, world. It can happen. As you can see, they're trying to take us back to that place, that God-awful place. A lot of us have not experienced it. We have, you know, read about it in the books, you know, the history books, and, you know, seen it in museums and all of that stuff, and know that our ancestors have had to live through that experience. But we haven't. We haven't really lived through that experience, right? So y'all need to be educated on how this law is going to work. What are the main components of this law? Because there is a lot to it, okay? A lot of you all don't read things, and you need to start reading. Reading is fundamental, y'all. And y'all are going to have to get educated on what's to come, because it is a lot that we're going to have to deal with, okay? First of all, another thing I wanted to talk to you all about, this gun violence, okay, that's plaguing our communities, y'all, okay? It is off the damn chain. I don't know what we're going to do about this, but what I know is, one thing's for certain, two things for sure, something is going to have to be done with this. So this is to my elected officials all over this country. All right. You know, y'all ask us to vote for you all of the time. Y'all come out, y'all summons us and beg for our votes all of the time. But how come when it's time to hear our voices, you don't want to do that? And this is to my elected officials. I really want to know. Y'all come out, Y'all put these god-awful, you know, mail-in circulars on our doors and mail them to us. Y'all come out. Some of you all come outside of our communities because you don't come into our communities. You get all over the TV. You have these campaign signs all outside of our communities. But yet, when it's time for us to use our voices on certain issues, you don't want to hear it. How come? You know? How come, you know, you don't want to hear it? You don't want to hear, you know, what's going on. Did a lot of you all watch the hearings for the COVID-19 situation that we have been going through for the last past 3 years? Did you tune into that yesterday? See, this is the thing. A lot of times, y'all need to be informed. You, all it takes is y'all go on these, you know, social media platforms and, you know, for all kinds of reasons. Besides for the reasons that you need to be on these social media platforms, and that's getting educated, okay? Because that hearing was very important, especially for the American people, to understand the place that we have been in and why we have been in that place. There have been many theories surrounding, you know, the issue with COVID and how it, you know, appeared here. There's many scientists, there's many people, you know, from the Center for Disease Control. They're saying this and they're saying that, but the one thing remains the same. Listening to them hearings yesterday, a lot of them know that COVID was created in a lab somewhere, okay? And basically, it got out, okay? Basically, the infection got outside of this lab, okay? It got outside of the lab. And a lot of our elected officials knew what was going on with the situation. They were even funding. They were funding many of these laboratories in Wuhan, China. And they were working on this situation and it got outside of the lab. Okay? And that's what a lot of the scientists, a lot of the people that have did research on this situation when it's, you know, surrounding COVID, they have came to that conclusion. And then there's some that want to blame it all on the animals. They want to blame it on the animals in the wild. They were telling us that, you know, people were eating bats and that's how we were getting, you know, people were contracting and coming, you know, in contact with this infection, which is more people saying that this thing just basically leaked from this lab. And then there's other people saying, you know, a few people saying that it came from the wild. And when I look at the people who are making these allegations, okay, and that have actual proof, because we have some, you know, they came up with, they came out ready, okay, when they did that hearing yesterday. A lot of people who have came to their conclusions on how this whole thing came about, they came out ready. Okay? And they had things proven that this thing was going on in some lab and it actually got out. Okay? And they're trying to say that Anthony Fauci, the person that we heard all about, Dr. Fauci, you know, he was telling us all of this mess, you know, when it first came about, you know, they were, it was like the blind leading the blind. Y'all remember that god-awful time? Our schools were shut down. Things were at a standstill. Everything was at a standstill except for crime, okay? Because in the last past 3 years, crime has been on an all-time high. And so has gentrification, because it didn't stop gentrification either. but it shut down us as the people. It messed us up mentally too, because a lot of us were, like I said, it was the blind leading the blind. And us as American citizens, all we wanted to know was how this thing all came about. How could we stay safe in this situation? You know, how can we protect our families, our children? We lost over 1 million people, y'all. We lost over 1 million people, right, to this deadly virus. Over 1 million people. And most of us lost family members. Like, I had a really, really hard time during that time. And then, you know, they say that this thing touched surface December of 2019 is when they first got, you know, their first case of it. But during that time, we were distracted by the death of Kobe Bryant and his daughter. Y'all remember that? Because they had that all plastered all over the news and the newspapers and all of that stuff. But in some of those newspapers, they also had, they were talking about the coronavirus. And y'all remember how all of those people were dying on vacation. We had couples dying on vacation. Y'all remember that? And they were dying from these mysterious diseases and stuff and illnesses and things. And some of them, you didn't even hear about it anymore. And I believe that that thing, that COVID, was around for a very long time. And we had incompetent leadership that could not put us, you know, get us prepared for that. Trust and believe me, we have went through many different pandemics, and we didn't even know it. H1N1, you know, this thing had been going on for a while. We were in the mix of pandemics, and we didn't even know it. Yeah, it was a mess. They was just telling us all kinds of stuff, y'all. And, you know, then we had our social media pharmacists, right? That was telling us, you know, you need to take the all of these different types of herbs and spices and things to, like, you know, Blaq people didn't get it. Y'all remember that? Y'all remember them telling us, saying, you know, people were, had this thing going on. They were like, Blaq people didn't even get COVID. Y'all remember that? And so we had, everything was still open. I know it was in D.C., okay? The go-go's were still going on. The parties, you know, the things were still going. The events in the park. Everything was still going on as if nothing was going on. And we had people dying left and right. Left and right. We had people dying. People scared. I remember when I first heard of COVID, right? I was, at the time, I was at Hustle Firm Radio, because I've been doing radio for 7 years. I just started, you know, recording from home, you know, to do more, get more information out there, right? But at the time, I was at Hustle Firm, and I remember I had a 73-year-old co-host at the time, and we had, you know, started this thing where we were going down to the Senate office buildings. And we would do that at least 4 times a month, right? And we would hand deliver letters to all 100 senators about the issues. And I remember us hand delivering a letter to our senators because we were really concerned about the people who were just dropping dead and these different people who were going on vacationing in these different places and they were just turning up dead. We had couples that died. We had sisters, cousins, and stuff that was out on vacation and they just died. And so me and my co-host was a little concerned about that, right? And so we also had been hearing about these mysterious illnesses that nobody wanted to talk about. So we wrote up a letter and we went to the Senate office building and we put one in each senator's hand. And then the next thing I know, like I said, Kobe Bryant passed away. And then we started hearing more about these illnesses coming up, okay? First it was, you know, the people dying in these mysterious ways, and then the COVID situation came up, right? And so then I remember before they had even put, you know, made it mandatory for us to wear masks, before they even made it mandatory to protect our first responders, because I was concerned about everything, especially going to the grocery store. You know, we had situations in my community where people who you go into the grocery stores and you're used to seeing, they had passed away. In some of our, you know, local grocery stores. People that you had, you know, you shop at this, a certain place, I shop at certain places. So it was kind of hard for me to go in there and not see my favorite cashier or not see my favorite person at the meat department. That was a little, it was hurtful, you know, to see that. And so me and my co-host, I'm living in Prince George's County at the time, right? And so me and my co-host decided to write to Annapolis. And because we wanted to make masks mandatory, especially when you're going into grocery stores and stores, you know, with our first responders, because they had to be there, y'all. If we didn't have our grocery store workers and, you know, people at the fire department and, you know, in our stores and things working, you know, then we would not have been able to really survive through this thing. You know, so they had, we started writing about that. You know, we wanted them to put some things into place to protect our first responders. So then once we started doing that, we started with Prince George's County. And then they made it mandatory. I know we weren't the only people. It was, you know, other people who, you know, wanted people, you know, our first responders, our children, people to be protected. So, you know, we wrote a letter, we went down to Annapolis, and we got our voices heard. And then the next thing you know, they started putting up the shields and things at the grocery store, cashiers and things. And they made it mandatory, and then they started putting the little 6 feet apart signs and things on the floors and things like that. Because, see, when it's stuff like that going on, I know that I have a voice, and as long as I am a registered voter, that it's my right to participate in the process of voting, right? It's my right to do that. It's my obligation and my responsibility to participate in the process of voting. Now, what that looks like for me is showing up at the town halls. It's writing a letter if I have to. It's making a phone call to my elected official. Not just my elected officials, because I understand that what happens in one part of this country affects us all. So when I was going down to the Senate office building hand-delivering letters, I hand-delivered letters to all 100 senators on these concerns because we all were faced with different concerns. And like I said, what affects one part of the country affects us all. That's just how I feel about it. So So participating in the process of voting for me is making a phone call, is using my rights to go down to the Senate office buildings and to talk to these people, to get straight in their face and tell them what is going on in my community, in your community. That is my job. That is your right. A lot of you all are not here in the District of Columbia, so you cannot partake in going down to the Senate office buildings. And I'm going to tell you something. Since people have caught on that you can do that, they have made it a little harder, right, for us to do this now. Okay, once they closed up outside, because we got to go, I want to say March the 13th of 2020, I want to say, when they put that whole thing into place where they started closing down industries and, you know, stuff like that, we had already been down there, like, I think it was like twice that month. And so when we geared up to go the third time, we found out that they had closed everything down. We couldn't go in there no more. And so, you know, we started sending emails and everything, following up with a phone call. And then when they opened the outside back up, what happened was, is that when you used to could go down there and you can put a letter or set up an appointment with any senator, right? But then they made it hard for us. When they opened outside back up, what they did was they told us that you can only see your senator from your state. That's what they told us. You can make an appointment to go see another senator, but you have to, if they don't want to see you, then they don't have to see you. So that's how that was, you know, all went about. They don't want to see you. They don't have to see you. You know what I'm saying? So they made it hard for us to be able to go down there once we got, because when I first went down there, y'all, I'm going to tell you the experience. It was empowering. It was just motivating. Because it was something that I never did before. First of all, I didn't know that I can do that. I didn't know that I can go to the Senate office buildings, you know, and see them face to face and tell them about what's going on in my community, in my part of the world. And when we first went down there, they looked at us like we were science projects. Why? Because they didn't see people like us, meaning Blaq folks. They didn't see us coming down there with letters wanting to talk about the issues. When you go up into them senators' offices, right, they got a TV in there. And the only thing that they're concentrating on is what's going on the Senate floor. That's all. That's what their TVs is turned to. That's what those TVs is centered on. What's going on the Senate floor? Nothing else. They didn't know about 8-year-old Relisha Rudd. They didn't know about Marty William McMillan Jr. They didn't know about any Akia Eggleston or, you know, any of Keisha Jacobs, you know, Kiara Coles. They didn't know about any of our missing people. I had to take it to them. I had people that was in them Senate office building busting out in tears to hear about such stories. Because they're centered on one thing. Something that we are not. You have to start participating in the process of voting, you guys. You have to make the phone calls. You have to get your voices heard. It's very important to do so. You have to get your voices heard. enough with the nonsense of saying my vote don't mean nothing, my voice don't mean nothing. If enough of us get together, we can make a difference. Good morning, y'all. We can make a difference. We really can. But it's time for us to start taking control. Participating, y'all. Let me tell you something. My mom, my grandmother, the only thing they told me was how important it was to vote. So when I became of age to get my voter's registration and everything, I took pride in that. And I didn't understand the full meaning of this whole thing. Like, I just didn't understand, you know, what this thing was really, really, really all about. Somebody had to pull me and say, let me educate you on the three branches of government, because they had got to a point, because our kids don't know a lot of things, you know, when it comes to the three branches of government, because they have taken civics out of school. See, a lot of y'all don't even pay attention. They had taken civics out of school, and I know they took civics out of school in Prince George's County, because me and my 73-year-old co-host fought to get it put back in schools. We stayed up on what was going on. Participating in the process of voting is being involved, making sure that we hold our elected officials accountable. Because see, that's where they fail us at, because they come out, they summons us for our votes. But when it comes to hearing our voices, they don't want to do that, but we have to make them want to do that. And we have to be educated on how to participate in this process of voting, y'all. It's just that simple. And watch how things will change. Things change dramatically when you participate. I remember, like I said, when I wrote my first letter, I remember seeing some change in that from making my first writing my first letter and taking it down there. I remember going down to the Senate office building, and like I said, when we first went down there, they looked at us like science projects. And then as we started to make it a routine, they basically knew us on a first name basis. They really did. And I remember running into Senator Tim Kaine in the hallway. And I remember him saying to me and my co-host, keep up the good work. Because one phone call to, you know, a person like me is like receiving 1,000 phone calls. One phone call is like, and Senator Tim Kaine told me that. Virginia, okay, he told me that. One phone call is like receiving 1,000 phone calls, because we know that people are paying attention. See, you have to put that stuff, things that you need changes in, you have to put it in their mind before they reach the Senate floor, before they start writing up bills and legislation, you know, that we need. We need a lot, y'all, and we need a lot to protect us. These families are going through hell right now, far as the judicial system is really messed up. You know, I have cases that have been lingering since Jesus was a baby. And every time the trials come up, they basically put them off. And they keep doing that. And I'm finding that they're giving plea bargains to murderers. Plea bargains to murderers. So our families who are victims who have loved ones who are victims of homicides are not getting justice. They're not. And it's hard. And a lot of them are not being protected. The case for 17-year-old Jalen Jones, who was brutally murdered. He was actually reported missing January the 24th. No, January the 16th, 2022. He was reported missing in Montgomery County, Maryland. Okay? Now, the backstory on Jalen, and I have posted, you know, clips from the interview that I did with Jalen's mom, Alexis. We talked about that case and how she had been failed. Jalen had been being bullied. And if anybody know about Montgomery County, Maryland, they're all for themselves. And I'm just going to leave it like that. Okay? Because I don't want to get, you know, my lives blocked and all of that. When it comes to Montgomery County, they're for themselves. Alexis had been fighting because her son was being bullied. Okay? Her son was being bullied. Now, the backstory on them is that Alexis came to Montgomery County, Maryland from Memphis. Okay, Memphis, Tennessee. And she researched. And this was 18 years ago. She researched places to raise her family. And they told her by that research that Montgomery County had great schools, great place to raise your family, crime wasn't high, you know, the whole nine yards. They sold it. Okay, they sold it to the point where a mom packed up her two children and she came to Montgomery County for a new way of life. And once she got here, things was good at first until her children got of school age. Okay, until her children got of school age. All right. So, Jalen had been being bullied from middle school until the day he died. And when I say bullied, I don't mean just the average thing where somebody is just talking bad about you, you know, shoving you in a locker, all of that type of mess. I'm talking about to the point where he was being jumped, okay, on a regular. They had jumped him one time. Like 9 individuals. They stood around. They filmed it. They had it all over social media. And they jumped him. And they put him in a hospital with a concussion. When it came time for things to be done, you know what they did? They made her move her child to another school. Okay? And then the bullying continue to progress, okay? And these same boys, Jalen was, to make a long story short, there were 5 individuals involved under the age of 17 who murdered Jalen, okay? He was reported missing. He was found, I think it was the 24th of January, face down in a creek in Montgomery County, Maryland. He had been stabbed over 100 times, and he had been beat beyond recognition. They had taken his backpack. All of this was over a game, okay? All of this was over a damn game, okay? Some kids wanted his game, and they took his backpack. They left him out there with no shirt on. No shoes. Okay? And this is a fact. You go look at up Jalen Jones. They would not allow me on social media, especially on TikTok, when I posted the pictures of Jalen, they wouldn't allow me to put them up. When I first read about that case and I first talked to his mom and I looked at those pictures and that video that she sent me, looking at that baby was just like looking at the picture of Emmett Till. No bullcrap, y'all. That's how horrific he was being. Imagine, he had been stabbed in the face. He had been beaten beyond recognition. They hit him with the butt of a gun. Stabbed him over 100 times. Face, upper body. And a 17-year-old boy went through this. And this was 5 17 children under the age of 17 with that much hatred in their heart. I always ask myself when I hear of these type of god-awful stories, and I hear many of them, when I hear of these god-awful stories, I always ask, you know, I always ask, what possesses these children to have so much hatred in their heart to do something as horrifying as that? What possessed these children to do such things? I would never understand. And court has been going on for her. Trial starts in May. I will be there. I will keep y'all updated on what's going on. Of course, there's a lot of things we're not going to be able to talk about until it's completely over. But I'm going to keep you updated on how this trial is going when it starts in May, this coming May. And y'all, looking at that picture, I told Alexis, I said, this is like Emmett Till. This is the modern day, I named that the modern day Emmett Till. But what was so messed up about this situation, it was 4 little Blaq boys who did this to another Blaq boy in a white system, in a low system. I mean, in a white system, right? That's what I got from that. His mother had to go through hell. Okay. And so when I met her after reading her story, because see, I had shared his flyer, you know, when he was reported missing, but I got the pleasure of meeting her. Our first conversation was a 5-hour conversation over the phone because I wanted to understand. I wanted to offer her resources, but first I needed to understand what she needed. And so after talking to her, I knew that she needed a lawyer because there was some wrongful death going on right there. I knew that she needed some other counseling and things because she just needed help because she had taken off with this thing and she didn't have no help. She had no help, y'all. And so to hear that, she had no help. It was horrifying to know that she did not have no help. And so what I did was I made sure that she had the resources. I made sure she had the lawyer to confide in. I made sure that she had every resources that she needed. And at the time, me and her just had a conversation a couple of days ago. And she told me, she was like, Miss Rose, I thank you so much for coming into my life because I was at a point where I was going through some things. She said, I was walking around here with a hole in my stomach and I didn't even know it. This thing had got me so down and just had me so messed up. I wasn't even concentrating on my health. I was getting sick in the mix of trying to fight for my son. And she was like, she had passed out, right? And had to be rushed to the hospital. She was unconscious. She said, in the midst of all of that, she said that her son came to her, grabbed her foot, and told her, Mama, you're going to be all right. She said, when me and Tanya came into her life, it couldn't have happened at a better time because she was able to let go of that and put that in our hands while she concentrate on getting well. Because see, that's my whole goal as an advocate. I'm not going to get involved in something if I can't do something to help, because that is my goal. That is my goal, to make sure that my families have all of their needs met, because they're going to be going through some things, y'all. They go through some things. I have set up on the phone with parents who have lost loved ones, who have missing babies and stuff for hours, 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning. Can't sleep, can't eat, can't function. I have had to be the mouthpiece for some families because they just didn't have the strength. I had the family of Olga Oro tell me, look, her dad told me, look, just you do the interviews, you deal with this. And just keep us informed on what's going on. Because they just could not deal with it. And I did just that. Even though it was hard for me. I don't do news interviews unless I have to. Because I really don't like it. It's bigger than that for me. That's something that we have to do to get these stories out here. But I much rather educate y'all and have y'all as my followers, as my social media family, to share these stories and help me help these families get this information out here. And I'm pretty sure a lot of the content creators that's centered around missing and murder cases, we need y'all help to get this information out here. Trust and believe me, I always interview my families. I'm not going to bring no information to you all if I have not gotten a clear from a family, if I have not gotten a go ahead. And when I'm bringing them to you, I'm bringing them straight from these parents. That's who I'm bringing it to you from. So I need, you know, I thank y'all for continuing to, you know, participate and sharing. And I need for y'all to get on board. Start vetting these presidential candidates. Start doing what you're supposed to do. Okay? I need for y'all to get on board with this. All right? Because 2024 is like right around the corner. And we have some changes that we have to make. And it's up to us. Start being participating in the process. Start educating yourself. Go to these websites, read up on some of these things. It doesn't take nothing but a minute. Start being involved in your representation on who is representing you all. Who is representing you? Get to know these people who are representing you. I don't care what part of the country you in. Get to know these people. Vet them. Hold them accountable. Make them do what they supposed to do. They asked for your votes, didn't they? Hold them accountable. First of all, learn how to hold people accountable. Learn their job descriptions so you won't have no mistakes. They can't tell you, oh, Like I've heard before, oh, I don't do this. I just write legislation. I just do this. I just do that. Learn their job descriptions. Be on their asses like a cheap suit if you have to, because your livelihood is at stake. Understand that. Your livelihood is at stake. Your health care, your taxes, your children's education, your housing. It's all at stake. It's all at stake. It is not a game. Get educated, y'all. Understand that you have the power to change all of this. Don't think you don't. They want y'all to think y'all don't have the power to make a difference in none of this, but you do. If you didn't, if voting wasn't important, they wouldn't be trying to stop you from doing it. They wouldn't be putting up goddamn red, you know, putting up roadblocks along the way to stop you from doing it, to, you know, to limit how you do it. They wouldn't be doing that if it was not important. Understand that. So don't be sitting up here talking about my vote don't mean nothing. Yes. And if we all paid attention, if we all did it together, it would be mean even more. We have the power to take back control. I don't want to hear that anymore. I don't want to hear you don't have power. I don't want to hear anymore that your vote don't mean nothing. My vote don't matter. I don't want to hear that no more. It's depressing. Because it just lets me, it makes me feel like y'all done gave up hope. And we can't do this shit alone. We need everybody, all hands on deck. Because we're being affected by this. We are being affected by this. Like I said, if they put a Jim Crow, bringing it back to existence in Mississippi, they can do it in any other state. They can do it in any other state. Understand that. This is just the tip of the iceberg on what they can do. To be honest with you, and what they're going to do. Because, see, they just testing the waters right now. They seeing how they can get this shit off. Oh, we done got it all. We done took it back to Mississippi. Okay? We done took it back where it all kind of started at. We gonna show these people. That's what they saying to us. Because why? We distracted because we killing each other. Stabbing and shooting and choking and every goddamn thing else to one another. Unaliving one another like it ain't nothing. That's the distraction. That's the distraction. Because that's what we doing. That's what we have been doing on an all-time high. Hey, every time you turn on the TV or I go on Facebook or some social media platform, that's all they talk about. It's how we're unaliving one another. Blaq America, we is unaliving one another like it ain't no tomorrow. Unaliving our children, and our children are out here committing a lot of these crimes. And why? Because they don't have no backbones. But just imagine, like I said before, that they start holding you parents that's not caring about your children, that's putting them in situations where they have to be the man of the house and all of this other crazy nonsense. Just imagine if they start holding y'all accountable for your children's misdoings and them doing being bad and doing bad shit. Just imagine if y'all was held accountable for that. How would you feel about that? If they locked you up because your child stole the car, or your child killed somebody. Suppose they did that. Our government has the power to put any law take any law away and everything. And y'all give them the absolute power because y'all don't say nothing. Y'all sit back and y'all twiddle y'all thumbs. Y'all don't even pay attention to what's going on half of the time. A lot of y'all ain't even know slavery been on a damn ballot for a very long time. It ain't never changed. It ain't never, ever changed. Whose fault is that? Learn how to participate in the process of voting. Okay? And I'm going to leave y'all with this, right? Today's numbers, when it comes to gun violence deaths, 7,856 people. See that? See that? Total number of gun violence deaths. You see that? Have just lost their lives to gun violence just in these last 3 months. Just in the first 3 months of the new year, 2023, in this country, 7,856 people have lost their lives due to gun violence. And gun violence deaths, every form, whether it's suicides, and suicides on an all-time high, okay? Mental health is on an all-time high. Like I was saying, going through this pandemic, people that were already messed up and going through, not messed up, but going through some things. Just imagine how the pandemic, where it put them at. Just imagine that. Just imagine the food stamps that's been taken away, people's housing been taken away, healthcare, schools been knocked down, closed up. Just imagine what that thing does to people's mental. The people that have had businesses since Jesus was a baby and no longer have them no more because they couldn't sustain, because they wasn't able to get the loans and things that they needed to keep their businesses alive. We have a lot to deal with. So it's up to us to be a part of the change that we drastically need to see. Right? So just keep that in mind. 7,856 people, as of when I printed this up, just this morning, in the last past 3 months of the new year, 2020. Have lost their lives to gun violence. Okay. This evening, 1:30 sharp, I will be going live on my social media platforms with attorney Tanya Sweat. We're going to be talking about the Jim Crow law in Mississippi that they just passed. We're going to give you the facts on that so that you can be educated on how this thing is going to work. A lot of people is not seeing past the word Jim Crow. You really need to understand what this means and how it can be a trickle effect for the rest of us. Okay? I love y'all so much. And I want y'all to be strong. And I need for y'all to get educated and understand what we're going through. We can do this, y'all. We can fight this thing. We can make some changes, and we got to do it together. This is not a one-person thing. This is not one person can do this. This is not not one person can do this. We all have to participate in this thing. We all have to be a part of the change that we want to see. All right? I love y'all. See y'all at 1:30 when I go live with attorney Tanya Sweat. And we're going to talk about the Jim Crow laws and what that means for Mississippi. and how it could affect the rest of us. All right? Because don't think it can't, because it can. All right? I love y'all. Be safe. And keep in mind that we can do this. Your vote, your voice means something. It matters. We got a lot at stake here, y'all. Keep that in mind. Don't think that this thing can't affect you, because it can. And it will. Okay? And I see y'all at 1:30. Have y'all paper and pens together so y'all can be able to jot down some information, because we're going to break it down to y'all exactly what this means. All right? And Tanya, attorney Tanya Sweat, is a person who, I'm going to give you a little bit about her background. She was a military lawyer. She was a JAG. She also ran for county executive, Prince George's County. She was a prosecutor, okay, a federal prosecutor. And she also was a, she wrote legislation, okay? She was part of writing legislation. So she's going to be able to break this thing down to you as to a science where you can understand. We're going to meet. It's time for us to meet each other where we are in this thing right here. We don't have time for the big words and all of that other shit. We're going to break it down to y'all what this means, what this Jim Crow law means, and how it can affect us, and how it might affect us. And this thing can be a trickle down effect. Just because they started it in Mississippi, brought it back in Mississippi, don't mean that they can't bring it somewhere else. And there's a lot of states that is vulnerable to this happening too. So I need for y'all to understand that too. All right? Love y'all. See y'all at 1:30. I will be live on Facebook with her. But I will be going live on TikTok. And y'all can go like my Facebook page and go and catch it there at Rose Brown, a.k.a. Blaq Rose on Facebook. Also on Instagram at Blaq Rose 44 on Instagram, okay? And I sure will be putting some clips up as well as what we talked about, all right? So that y'all can understand, because this is very important, all right? Love y'all. Be safe. Keep in mind what I said. It's not over for us. Don't just throw the goddamn towel in and wave the white flag. Put it down. Throw that goddamn thing away. It's time for us to get it together. Because we are all we have. And this is not a Blaq thing. This is not a white thing. This is a people's thing. Okay? This is a people's thing. Understand that. So let's get educated. Love y'all. Right, Facebook. I will see y'all this evening. Okay. I'm just testing out my little stuff. I'll see y'all this evening. I love y'all. Actually, this afternoon, I will be live, like I said, with attorney Tanya Sweat, and I'll see y'all at 1:30, okay? All right, y'all.